Good day, my dear followers. I am Dr. Javi, and today I would like to teach you about autonomous navigation. In my previous lesson, I explained how mobile robots find their location within a map and update their knowledge as they move through it. Today, I will explain how they can compute an efficient route between two positions. Before we start, I would like to introduce you to a mathematical tool known as graphs. A graph is simply a set of nodes, called vertices, and the connections between them, called edges. There are a lot of types of graphs with different properties, but let's keep things simple for the time being. As you might guess, a graph makes a rather tidy representation of a map, so we can use them as such in mobile robotics. Let us assume for now that the map we give our robot is, indeed, a graph. Finding a route between two locations looks quite simple now, doesn't it? Too simple, in fact. Pretty much any route we trace seems to work just fine. And we can't have that, we want our robot to choose only the most efficient option. So let's make our graph a bit more complete. Clearly, all the edges between vertices can be the same for our robot. If two connected vertices are further apart, their edge should reflect this distance. So let us give edges values, which represent how costly they are to pass through. This turns our map into a weighted graph. Now is when things get more interesting. As I have explained before, robot navigation works by trying to emulate the pathfinding skills which humans instinctively use. There are a lot of different techniques to achieve this, but if we use weighted graphs, the simplest method to find the shortest path between two vertices is DIJKSTRA'S algorithm. This algorithm analyzes every possible route from a starting point to a goal, choosing always the lightest edges and discarding the heavier ones. Let's see how it works with an example. Suppose we want to go from vertex A to vertex F in this simple graph. As people, we can clearly see that the shortest route will be A, C, B, E, F. Using DIJKSTRA'S algorithm, a computer can find that out too. By calculating the shortest distance from our starting point to every other vertex until it gets to its goal. At first, these values are unknown, so the computer will assume that they are all infinite, except for the distance from vertex A to vertex A, which is of course zero. The algorithm wants to be thorough, not to make any mistake, so it will keep a set of all the vertices it hasn't fully checked out yet, in order to visit them all one by one. At the beginning, it will always analyze the starting point and see where it can go from there. Every other vertex in the graph will be stored in this set of unvisited vertices for later use. Now, from vertex A we can get to vertex B along a 3 units long edge, or to vertex C along a 1 unit long edge. Now we know more about these two vertices, so we can update their information with a new distance and from which vertex they can be reached. Now we know everything we can learn from vertex A, so we must choose another one from the unvisited set. And we want to get the shortest possible route, so we will pick the vertex which currently has the smallest distance value. This is vertex C, with a distance of 1 unit from vertex A. From vertex C, we can get to B along a 1 unit long edge. If C is 1 unit away from A, and B is 1 unit away from C, that means that we can get from A to B through C, following a 1 plus 1, 2 units long route. We were previously reaching B directly from A, through a 3 units long route, so our new route is better. We can update this data to reflect that, if we reach it from C, it will only be 2 units away from A. We must also update every other vertex that can be reached from C. Going from A to D through C will produce a 1 plus 3, 4 units long route, and going from A to E through C will produce a 1 plus 4, 5 units long route. Now the vertex with the shortest distance from A is B, from which we can reach vertices D and E. Of course, we don't need to check the edges from B to A and from B to C, because those have already been fully visited. Now, the distance from A to D going through B will be 2 plus 4, 6 units. This is worse than our current 4 units. That's because getting to D through C is shorter than going through B, so we don't update this data. However, getting to E through B gives us a 2 plus 2, 4 units long route, which is better than E's 5 units. That means that getting to E from B is actually more efficient than getting there through C, so we do update E's data. This whole process is repeated until we have either visited all the vertices that can be reached by routes starting on vertex A, or until the goal vertex is no longer in the unvisited set. Once we are done, we will know from which vertex our goal F can most efficiently be reached, that is E. And we know that vertex E can be reached from B, then C, then A. So, as we knew from the start, the shortest route from A to F is A, C, B, E, F, which is exactly 5 units long. Now you know how DIJKSTRA's algorithm works. But what if the map that we give to the robot is not a graph? We can still use the tricks we have learned, but we first need to transform the map into a graph. The easiest, most common way to do this is to simply use a grid. If we divide the whole map into small cells and assume that the robot can only move between neighboring cells, we will have a big graph that our pathfinding algorithm can tackle. But this is very ugly and inefficient, isn't it? Let's learn a much better way to produce a graph from a map. Let's say that, for some reason, our robot must pass between these 2 point obstacles. Clearly, it will want to stay as far from them as possible to avoid collisions, so it will try to keep the same distance to both of them at all times. We know that the region of two-dimensional space that is always at the exact same distance from 2 points is a straight line. This is just basic geometry, so don't worry if you don't understand why this is so. It's simple mathematics. Let's now add a few more points. For every 2 points, the robot will need a straight line to mark the safest route between them. If we place a vertex wherever these line segments touch, we will have a Voronoi graph, which marks all the safest spots in our map and how to move from one to another. But let's make things a bit more difficult. Suppose that our robot must now find its way through a badly structured area like this one, with several irregular obstacles. First thing first, a robot can never assume that it can move close to another object, because a robot is not a single point, it's a volume, it has width and length, or, at the very least, a defined area of occupancy where collisions can happen. So it must absolutely keep a clearance distance from all obstacles at all time. In order to make calculations easier, we can just inflate all obstacles so that they include this safety distance. Now the robot knows how close it can get to any foreign object without crashing. The process to produce a Voronoi graph from this map is exactly the same as before, only a bit more complicated. We have to find all the paths within the map that keep an equal distance to each pair of obstacles. The easiest way to do this is to gradually inflate every obstacle some more until they touch one another. The lines where this happens are the edges of our graph map. Once we have them, we can simply measure their length and use DIJKSTRA's algorithm to compute a safe route between any two vertices. So now you know the very basic principles of autonomous navigation. There is, of course, a lot more to tell about this topic, like how to maneuver around unexpected obstacles or blocked pathways in dynamic environments. But these situations are just particular cases of what we have learned today, where the robot simply needs to recalculate its route with the new information it acquires. For now, I hope that you enjoyed this little lesson on mobile robotics. If you did, please let me know in the comments below and I'll keep making more of them. Thank you for your attention, and I hope to see you again soon.